pressing, but the sun is out. Hey, we're glad you're here for worship today, and one of my favorite choirs is here this morning. Kingdom Kids is going to sing for us as our call to worship as we begin this morning. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let's hear from the kids.
Good morning. Please rise and join me in prayer.
I don't think we can compete.
No, we can't compete with that.
Not part of that.
We're going to try and praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can gather here today. We thank you for the ways that you love us, the ways that you invite us in. God, we ask that you would fill us up this morning as we pour out our praises to you. We pray this in your name, Jesus.
Down at your feet. Oh, for feet to dance.
Come on.
For a heart to romance. Oh, for lungs to lift your name so high.
Give me you glory, I just can't give enough. You are so
lift your name so high.
As we consider this morning the ways that we pour out our love in response to God's love, as He invites us to the table, as we've been talking about for this past few weeks, and our response is to pour out these blessings. We know that when we come before the Lord in prayer, no matter what we say or bring to Him, He hears, He answers in His own time. And let's just take a moment, let's just spend some time in prayer before God this morning. Lord, we thank you so much that you fill us to overflowing with your love and your grace and your mercy today. And it's so great to be reminded of this as we are gathered as the body of Christ in this place. Lord, we have some prayers we want to bring before you. We ask for those in our congregation, Lord, who are sick, Lord, who are homebound, shut in, Lord, who are dying. Pray for your healing hand, God, that you would send your love and mercy to those who are sick, God, those who have cancer, those who have other diseases. God, we know that you're the great miracle worker, and we just pray for boldness, Lord. We just pray that you would heal them. Lord, we live in a country that's so divided, God, and we pray that you would be in the hearts and minds, Lord, of those who govern over us. We pray, God, that they would put their faces in your word, Lord, and that they would seek your will. Lord, you tell us that when we seek after you, God, that you will heal us. And so we pray today boldly in the name of Jesus that our leaders would come before you in faith. God, that they would seek your will, that they would seek your way, that they would turn to you, Lord, and that you would just move mightily in our country. We thank you, God, for our local and international ministries here at Our Savior. We thank you for Faith in Action, God, the opportunity to go out and serve our community, Pierce County, each month. God, for Backpacks for Kids, and we get to feed hundreds of kids each weekend. Lord, we thank you for those blessings. We pray internationally, Lord, we thank you for our Child Development Center in Nicaragua. We pray for the unrest there, and Lord, for Jeff and Rachel, God, who are doing missionary work around the world, be with them, keep them safe. And Lord, we thank you that you have developed such a heart for Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth ministry here. Keep moving in those ways for us. Pray for our OSLC family this morning, Lord, for boldness to preach the gospel, to live the gospel, to invite people to our tables, to take these things that we hear today and learn and apply them to our lives, God, out of response for who you are. And God, in this moment of silence, we lift up our own prayers, Lord, the prayers of our hearts. Hear us, Lord, as we bring them before you now in silence. God, we know that you hear every prayer, that you know the desires of our hearts. We pray that you would work boldly. Help us to remember, God, that it's in your time and your way. We trust you in all things, God. Lord, we speak together the prayer that you taught us in faith. Our Father, who art in heaven, be seated. We're going to hear from the word of the Lord this morning.
Good morning. Our scripture lesson today is from the book of Luke, chapter 14, verses 34 and 35. It'll be on the screen behind me, but it's also sometimes good to hold the Bible in your hand. So it's on page 874 in your pew Bible. Salt is good. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use, either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Here endeth the scripture.
For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior. Calls, bring it all to the table.
Well, good morning, church. Good morning. Hey, if you're new here, I'm Pastor Tim. It's great to be here with you. And if you found us online, good morning. Good morning, or whenever you're tuning in, it's good to be together. We're wrapping up this series called At the Table, and we've been on this journey, all right, discovering what it looks like for Jesus to invite not just us to the table, but really his world, because that's really his heart, is to get his world back, and he's not going to do it alone, and so we're wrapping that up. Before we get into it, just want to give you the bird's eye view of where we're going over the next few weeks, all right? Next week, we're going to have 24 or so mission partners up here at the beginning of our service as we celebrate what we call Mission Sunday. For those who are part of the OSLC family here, we give away about 10% of our annual income. We call that a tithe, all right, 10%. It amounts to about $160,000 or so, and about $106,000 of those dollars are going to go to these 24 organizations, and then the remaining of those dollars are dispersed through monthly gifts to some regional mission projects as well. So it's a great opportunity to come together, celebrate, learn about what these ministries that we partner with do that we just as a single entity, as a single church, just physically and realistically can't, all right? So they're going to have representatives here. They'll be set up out in the fellowship hall. It's going to be a celebration weekend, so make plans on being here. And then the following week, all right, February 16th, we're launching into a new series called Digital Gods, all right? Digital Gods. I'm not going to say too much, but you can imagine it probably has something to do with technology. And if that's what you're thinking, you've assumed correctly. Looking at how technology and faith all come together, and we don't want to demonize technology because God has created technology for good, right? He's created technology for good, and yet it can become almost godlike. And so we want to sit in that tension for a few weeks. So if you know someone who maybe wrestles with that, or maybe another parent or grandparents, like, man, what do I do with my kids? Because, man, it's just nuts, all right? Come, and we're going to be digging into God's Word and having some guests throughout those series to help us understand how best we can faithfully use technology as people following Jesus. All right, sound good? Awesome. Find a Bible. We're going to go to Luke chapter 14 as we kick in here. Thank you, John, for reading those verses, page 874. We started this series talking about this, all right? That God has invited you to have a seat at the table. And for those who have been tracking along throughout this series, we've really just been walking through Luke chapter 14. That's all we've been doing, is walking through this entire chapter. And so we're finally at the end, but that's where we started. And then we came across Jesus observing and looking at how people at the table that he invited to the table really kind of were behaving. And we discovered that Jesus looks for humility, humility which looks an awful lot like him, right? How he humbled himself, put himself last and not first. And so then we discover that God's going to get his people back to the table. That's Jesus' heart's desire. That is at the center of the heart of God, and he's choosing not to do it alone. And then he tells a story, and Pastor Matt helped us unpack this last week, of how the table is a place of grace, not judgment. And the invitation is there, and yet the table, it's not about God's stuff. It's about who he is. And he asked that wonderful question. Wasn't that such a great question, those of us who were here last week? I mean, how's your soul? Because if being here at God's table is really about God and who he is and our souls, then all the other stuff, it's nice. But let's keep the main thing the main thing. And here as Jesus kind of ties up all the loose ends in this last section. He really accents it with the verses we just heard. But let me give you some context here as we get into it, okay? Here's some context. Jesus now, verse 25, if you're there with me, great crowds were accompanying him. And then he turned aside and began speaking. So now he who was at the table has done what? Hello, are we awake? He's gotten up. And now the great crowd is following him. Jesus is going to leave the table, all right? And this is what he says to them. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my what? Disciple. Well, that just seems to contradict everything Jesus just said, right? No. Actually, what he's saying, it's actually quite profound. And what he's saying is that the invitation to the table is so much more than just coming and sitting and being. That there's so much more to this experience with Jesus and this relationship that we have with the one who has invited us, that now Jesus' invitation is, okay, let's stand on up and let's go. And what he's saying here isn't so much a literal, like you just got to leave your family and the people you love and the life that you live. But check out verse 27. He says, whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my what? Disciple, cannot be my follower, cannot be remaining with me. And so what he's saying here, if we put this all together with what he just said and now what he is saying, that this is going to be hard. It's not just going to be come and soak up and enjoy. That's a big part of it. But now Jesus is saying, sickness is going to come. Broken hearts are going to happen. Families might fall apart. Life as you know it just might not make sense. But realize what he says. It's about bearing that cross as it comes to you. It's not like we seek it out. It kind of happens to us. You know what I'm talking about? And for those who are saying, no, I'm not willing to get up and bear that cross, I'm kind of comfortable and happy just sitting right here. I'm good. He's saying, no, you just can't sit and stay here. You got to get up because I'm going somewhere else. There's other tables that I want to set. And so you can read the rest of those verses, but that's kind of the context here. And so if you drop down to verse 34, that's where we heard here today. He says, salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? Now let's just stop right there. Jesus, he talks about salt a lot. He's really echoing and piggybacking on these words that he spoke early on in his ministry. All right, let's read it together. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? So who's the salt of the earth? We are. You are. Go turn to somebody next to you and say, you're the salt of the earth. If you're at the table, you are the salt of the earth. If Jesus has extended an invitation to you, you are the salt of the earth. It's who you are. It's a gift that God has given you. He has given you everything you need to be the salt of the earth. So what is the salt of the earth? What does it mean to be salt? Think about it like this. Salt is a preservative, right? Salt's a preservative. And it preserves that which it absorbs into. It preserves it from decay. It prevents it from rotting. Parents, we know this, that salt, it preserves stinky socks from smelling. Try it. Because it just sucks the odors out. But think about it. If you have salt in a salt can or a salt shaker on your table, how good is it? It's not doing anything. It's just sitting there. In order for salt to actually work, you actually have to pour it out. It actually has to be absorbed into something. And this is Jesus' entire point. Being at the table, the invitation to be here, it's good. But it's not complete unless you also hear the invitation as Jesus gets up to pour you out like salt in the culture and into the lives and into the people around you. Think about it. As culture decays, as the world around us stinks, as life is hard and sometimes it just feels rotten, Jesus' promise is not just that, hey, I'm going to the cross, I'm going to die, so now you can live a happy, joy-filled life someday in heaven. No. Now it's no. You're going to be the salt of the earth who's going to bring hope and light to a world that's literally dying. That's what it means to be at the table, not just to come and be, but now to go and be the salt of the earth, to bring peace, this idea of wholeness or completeness, shalom, the connection between the Old Testament Hebrew understanding of peace and the New Testament rule and reign of peace, where it all comes together, where everything is the way it should be like, the way God intended. And that comes to you and to me when we think about life and our relationships, whether it's with our conversations or in our families or in our daily work lives or in our homes, that you and I, we are like salt, Jesus says. That's part of the invitation of being at the table, is that we are salt dissolved and poured out to preserve that which God has created. I mean, think about it. Place yourself in the... Let me back up. Put your current self, all right, your 2020 self back in the original time when people would have heard these words. Gospel of Luke, written somewhere in that, 50 to 80 AD sort of time frame. What was happening? Rome, right? Rome was literally burning. I mean, it felt a lot like this. Chaos was ensuing. I love what pastor, author, speaker Andy Stanley describes it as. He says, Nero's circus was in full swing. He burns the city, burns the Christians, sends his goons to capture the Christians, makes sports of them, tortures them, oftentimes burns them alive. It's absolute chaos, he says. Families are ripped apart. Everything seems to be consumed with darkness and sadness and abuse. hurt and loss and pain and grief. There are only a few ruling elite, but most are poor people unable to find adequate care for their diseases, care for their children, and seemingly nobody to stand with them in their corner. You can just feel the hopelessness and the despair of how those first hearers would have heard these words. You are salt. You are God's way of preserving that which I have placed you in. I mean, the words of the Apostle Paul just echo through the walls of this time in history too, when he says the battles that you fight are, they're not against flesh and blood, they're not against Nero or the rulers, but the battle is actually a spiritual war of the enemy, who is the powers and the darkness and the evil forces of this dark age. And so it's a different type of battle. The truth is, a lot of Christians during that time, they ran out of the city. They hid, they fled. And can you just imagine if your future self, like your 2020 self, would follow them out into the foothills? And if you just shared with them what we know now, what happened, like, guys, can you imagine this conversation? Guys. Do you know that in 300 years, Rome's going to look totally different? That Rome is going to be rebuilt, and instead of burning crosses, there's going to be crosses up on buildings? Wow, that's a different picture. Do you know that because Jesus followers, because Christians who were at the table chose to be salt in the way that Jesus had led them to be salt, that they will end up rebuilding the cities, that they will build hospitals and care for children and people with great diseases that nobody else would touch. That they would educate the next generation, the generation after that, and the generation after that, and teach them the things of God. And that the city would be a magnificent city. That things would change just in 300 years. If you only knew. Why are you hiding? Why are you just huddled up around your own table? And God has invited you to get up and go and be salt. And then if your future self could just kind of explain to them how that ripple effect would really ripple out thousands and thousands of years later to mid-Pierce County, Washington, the year 1961, that 80 people or so would gather in a little Grange Hall in mid-county, and that they would be there because they knew this promise that they too could be salt, that they too could be a living light, a living presence of Jesus and his hope that he has to bring to the world. And so they would start gathering and inviting more and more people to the table and being poured out as salt into the lives of more and more children and more families. And this would continue over and over and over again. Thousands of people would experience the same hope and joy and love and grace that they once experienced at the table thousands of years ago, that ripple affected into the lives of people right outside in our own neighborhoods. That they would invite friends, that they would sing the songs in a new sort of way, and they would engage the scriptures in ways that really meant something in their lives, that young people would experience friendship and deep relationships with each other, even with short shorts. That the impact of this invitation at the table would ripple for almost 59 years to to times where children go hungry and the preservation of being salt still delivers food into the hands of vulnerable young people. And they dance away, inviting their friends to hula and wear flowers or to give gifts at Christmas because of the generosity that was once shown to them by the God who invited them in the first place. Friends, that's what it looks like to be salt in the world, to be poured out. And it's not something new. It's something God has been doing for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. Even when there's coffee cans sitting collecting rain from the ceiling. And people who have been around here for years know what I'm talking about. The ceiling in the old worship center would leak, and there'd be these coffee cans. And yeah, there have been some scary times and fear-filled times, and yet God continues to say, come. Continue inviting people to the table so I can stand up and continue pouring you out like salt so that your communities, your families, your homes, your world can continue to be preserved by my love. So that others can see how my life and my death and my resurrection and the power of who I am, who Jesus is, can be seen and known by all people. If that was what it meant to be at the table, and that's what Jesus here is getting at. That the invitation is so much more than just coming and being. That's also, as Jesus gets up and goes, he says, let's go. Let me pour you out. Let me pour you out as salt. So you can continue inviting others, and by doing so, preserve life around you. I was reminded by this verse here, from Zechariah 4, verse 6. Let's read it together. This is the word of the Lord, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. I mean, this is so good because sometimes I think we look back at what God has done. It's like, man, look how good we are. Look how strong we've become, right? That'd be what the world would say as they look in at organizations and churches, right? Or look at the power that we have, like we have heavy hitters. But no, God says, no. All of this, it's by my what? Spirit. Church, may we never forget that this invitation to the table for you and for the world is always not by our might or by our own power, but by what? The Spirit. It's hard, isn't it? I mean, if it was easy, every church would be doing it. It is hard. But everything worth hard is worth fighting for. At least that's what my dad always told me. You know, just as we wrap up this series, let's just keep it simple. This invitation to the table begins with a covenant relationship with God, our Father. That's where it begins. It's his invitation to us to join him in what he's already doing as he forgives the sins, not just our own, but the sins of the world. As he goes and he brings health and healing to those who are sick and freedom to those who are in captivity to addictions and bondage and fear. It's the God who invites those who feel like they don't belong to a place where they feel like they do belong. And then as a shepherd, he stands up and he says, let's go. There's so many more tables. There's so many more places. There's so many more people. I want to get back to the table. That's not just going to be one big table, but there's going to be multiple tables in every home, in every workplace, in every network, in every school and every place imaginable where people can experience the love that I have for them. I'm reminded of Psalm 23. This actually stuck out to me here this week. I didn't really realize this until this week. Let's read this together. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. I never saw that before. That God, he prepares a table before us. Where? The presence of my enemies. Which tells us, yeah, it's going to be hard. The cost of following Jesus is going to be hard, but as we're poured out, we have the confidence that we have a place where we belong, that the table is ours. And I love how that psalm goes. If you're familiar with the psalm, you know it. How does it begin? The Lord is my, I shall not. He makes me lie down where? Green pastures. He restores my soul. He leads me beside quiet waters. And we could just go through there. It's like, oh my goodness, God has given us everything we need to do this with him. There's a story of two men, one young, one old. Church thought it would be really cute to have them recite the 23rd Psalm. Sounds like a nice thing to do. So they both prepare. The younger guy, very talented orator, theater major, comes out and just nails it. I mean, just nails it theatrically. And the entire crowd, you know, they applaud afterwards. They're just so impressed with this young guy. The old gentleman comes up with a cane up on stage, and just really feeble, and barely gets the words out. In fact, folks were sitting on the end of their chairs wondering if he's even going to finish. As he spoke those last words, you could hear a pin drop. In the silence, the young man came back on the stage and said these words. He said, "Friends, I wish to make an explanation. You applauded when I recited the psalm, but you remained silent when my friend here spoke. The difference is plain. I know the psalm. He knows the shepherd." Just an honest question this morning. Do you know the shepherd who has invited you to the table? Who's also the shepherd who invites you to stand up as he leads, to follow him? He's not going to lead you astray. He's the good shepherd. He's given you everything you need. He restores your soul. He leads you in green pastures, not dead pastures. And as a good shepherd, he leads you in a place where he knows you're needed, he knows that you're well-loved and protected, and yet he knows the power of the flock. That like salt, that the flock can literally preserve life, preserve the culture. He says, "You flock are the salt of the earth." As we wrap up the series, I want to just ask two questions. And today, we want to just give you an opportunity to respond and to sit with this conviction and this simple truth that the same shepherd who has invited you here is the same shepherd who leads you wherever there is. So here are the two questions, all right? And our worship team, they're going to come up and lead us in a time of worship, and we'll have communion. But here's the first one. Do you have a covenant relationship with the shepherd? And if you do, you know the invitation is always yours. And maybe you say, "I'm not sure," or maybe I don't. I don't know. My prayer today is that the good shepherd would keep on reminding you that you are loved, that you are forgiven, that you always have a place at the table. And here's the second question. If he is your shepherd, where has he strategically led and placed you to be salt in life. Could be at your workplace. Could be just in your home. Could be a school. It could be your neighborhood. Could be a Super Bowl party where there's a bunch of 49er fans. Or Chief fans. But that's a question you'll have to answer, not me. I can't tell you that. But what I do know is that the Good Shepherd loves you, that he's invited you to take your place with him, and that he continues to lead you to be salt where you're at, to preserve life, to bring hope and healing and light to people in darkness. He wants to get more people to his table, and he's not going to do it alone. He's going to choose you, salt, yeah, you, to do it. So we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit this morning that those who do not have a relationship with you, who do not know you as their good shepherd, Lord, maybe our prayer this morning is simply, Lord, create faith in my heart. It's not by my own will or my own might or my own power. It's by your Spirit. So God, I give up control once again. I surrender to the desire to be right or the desire to completely understand and simply rely on your Holy Spirit who gives me this invitation. And by that same Spirit, I say yes. Yes, I belong here. Lord, confirm and affirm in us where you have placed us, that it's exactly where you would have us to be salt, to preserve the life of others, to speak words of hope and encouragement, of love and grace. Lord, may we always know that you're our good shepherd, that you're my shepherd. So may your Spirit lead us to respond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand as we respond. Worship our glorious God who invites us to the table. His love never fails. Inside the mystery, see the empty cross, see the risen Savior, victorious and strong. No one else above him, none is strong to save. He alone has conquered. Power of the grave, glorious. My eyes have seen the glory of the Lord. Glorious. He stands above the rulers of the tombstone, see the living God, see the resurrected ruler of my heart. Lift it up. No one else above him, none to match his word, the hope of his returning. Yeah. faith. God, and we come before you with things, Lord, that maybe we've offended you with this week. Things that we should have done that we didn't do. Things that maybe we said to others out of spite or anger. God, things that we're not proud of. And Lord, we come to you this morning. We kneel at your cross and we ask for forgiveness. Because we know, Lord, that you are slow to anger, abounding in love, rich in mercy. So God, as we think about and concentrate on those things, the things that we know, the things that we don't know, because there are so many of those as well, God, we bring those before you as we silently confess our sins to you today and beg for your mercy and forgiveness.
Greatest message the world has ever received is one of hope and healing. The God of the universe has chosen to send his son Jesus, not just to redeem our bodies and to preserve our bodies and on the last day raise our bodies, but in the here and now to forgive our sin. The spiritual disease that we have, and he declares it to be done in the person and work of Jesus. I mean, that's what this meal is all about, is Jesus' body broken for you, his blood given and shed for you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Which just doesn't preserve our lives, but actually heals and restores us. So rejoice. Be glad. May you be at peace because the God who sent Jesus has forgiven all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. Jesus, the night he was betrayed, took bread. He gave thanks. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body that's given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks, and he gave it to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this now as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Be seated as we continue to worship this morning. Thank you.
Hope we have in Jesus.
There is a song I know it well, a melody that's never failed. high, valleys low. My soul will rest, my confidence in you alone. Stand as we sing. Hope has a name, his name is Jesus. My Savior's cross has set the sinner free. Hope has a name, his name is Jesus. Christ be praised, I have victory.
Amen, church. Creed together as one body. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
and
in Jesus Christ, his only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven. Thanks.
Amen. Friends of Christ, be seated. We continue to worship by giving God back the first fruits through our time of offering. And as the ushers are coming around, make sure you fill out your connection card. We want to know that you're here, and make sure if you have prayer requests, put those on there too. And while we do that, let's watch our video, What's Going on OSLC Life.
Church, and welcome to OSLC Life. My name is Julianne Detweiler, and I am so glad you came to worship with us this morning. As the ushers are coming around with offering plates, please fill out the front and back of your connection card and then either drop it in the offering plate or give it to an usher before you leave so we can stay connected with you. Each year as a church, we support many local, regional, and global ministries, and we want to celebrate them on Mission Sunday, which is February 9th. Come meet our ministry partners and learn how you can become involved in the work they do as we recognize and celebrate what God is doing around the world through OSLC. Hey, women of OSLC, the IF gathering is coming, and even though I couldn't physically attend last year, I was incredibly moved by the online experience, and I am beyond excited to join you this year on March 14th from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. Whether you are 14 or 94 years old, let's gather together to worship, pray, fellowship, and hear from both national speakers as well as women from our own church. Come be a part of this national movement as we consider God's call in our lives. You can register today at goOSLC.com/ifgathering. Nursery care and scholarships are available.
And gentlemen, don't worry, we didn't forget about you, because there's a men's breakfast coming up for you guys on Leap Day, February 29th from 8:45 to 10 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. This is a great chance to get together as men of all ages. So come hang out with us, eat lots of bacon, and be encouraged in your faith and your life together at the men's breakfast.
Join us Saturday, February 15th at 8 a.m. in West Campus for our monthly Faith in Action Day of Service. We are excited about the opportunity we get every month to go out into the community to serve those in need. Faith in Action provides amazing opportunities to work side by side with our OSLC family and help build personal connections with your community. We are so glad you came to worship with us today. As we go this morning, remember that God has invited you to the table to receive His grace. And He calls all of us to invite others this week as you love God, love people, and live like Jesus.
How can you be salt this week? Go with that question on your mind. Let's stand as we're sent to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We have our prayer team over by the window over here if you'd like prayer here as you leave. So the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you, be gracious to you, look upon you with His favor, and as always, give you His peace. Amen. Let's sing.
Actually, let's go in peace. Have a great week. Enjoy the game. See you later.